Hello, I'm Darren. We have breaking news. More than 600,000 Americans have kidney failure. While the number of people with kidney failure is enormous, the number of people with its precursor, chronic kidney disease, is staggering. An estimated 31 million Americans, or about 10% of the US population. Diabetes and hypertension cause 2/3 of all cases of kidney disease. 1 out of every 3 Americans is at risk for kidney disease, and kidney disease is now among the top 10 causes of death in the United States. In addition, 9 out of 10 people with early to moderate kidney disease don't know they have it, putting their health in jeopardy. Are you at risk? For more information, contact urbankidneyalliance.org. The life you save may be yours.
Time it is. Marvin Devine, Huber, Axel, and you know how we do.
Yeah, I got the juice. Weird game cool, make them look like cool. Always play it cool, that's the biggest rule. Yeah. Forget what they doing, keep on doing. I made it right here in the booth. I'm always pursued, cause of what I pursue. That's greatness, yeah, I gotta make it, I got things to lose. Boy, wanna get in my crew, boy, can't get in my crew. Me, Axel, and Huber, way too fireful. When this joint drop, better call the troops. And when you hear the drop, better raise the roof.
You already know what happens when we link up. Let's go.
Yeah.
Around, don't get caught in the mosh pit. Fuel to the fire, ain't nobody can stop it. Trouble in my city, but you know I'm across it. Got a 40 on my hip and I'm liable to spark it. Throw down these hits, my click is indivisible. I aim, you duck, I squeeze, now you invisible. I'm not afraid of getting physical. All these different chemicals are fogging up my visual. Bloods on my hands, got slugs on my gunners. Yo, we notorious, we ain't no runners. Bloods on my hands, got slugs on my gunners. Yo, we some warriors, they ain't no gunners. Bloods on my hands, got slugs on my gunners. Bloods on my hands, got slugs on my gunners. Put on my strap, put on the beat, put on the map, put on my team. Take out every motherfucker in between, know what I mean? Better myself, better my aim, better my breath, better my name. Killing rappers on my hang, I'm running chains for the fame. Never thought I would, now I'm running. You don't wanna follow me, I'm like in front of.
Good evening, and welcome to a special broadcast of Steve the Kidney Nurse. I'm your host, Steve Belcher. Thank you for watching tonight. Look, this is going to be a great show tonight. You can watch this show on the Urban Health Outreach Media Network, Facebook page, and Steve the Kidney Nurse YouTube channel. Look, it's great to be back on air. It's been about 2 to 3 months since I actually done the show. I took a mental health break, and let me tell you, that break was definitely good. So I'm back tonight for a special show, and then starting in August, September, we're going full blast again for a new season. Great topics, great show. It's going to be some new stuff you haven't seen. Oh, it's going to be awesome. So tune in this fall for new episodes of Steve the Kidney Nurse right here on Urban Health Outreach Media Network and Steve the Kidney Nurse YouTube channel. Now tonight, I have a special guest. I mean, this brother's all the way from New York. Tonight's guest is Dr. Philippe Douyon, who is a kidney warrior, an author, motivational speaker, and founder of the Inlay Brain Fit Institute. Now, you're going to want to remember that, the Inlay Brain Fit Institute, okay? Dr. Douyon is a board-certified neurologist. He completed his residency in neurology at New York University and fellowship at New York Presbyterian Cornell in clinical neurophysiology, okay? He spent the last several years caring. Now look, he not only deals with the disease, but he spent the last several years caring for people with neurological disorders with a special emphasis on people with history of epilepsy. So if you got epilepsy or history, you're gonna wanna watch this show. Seizure disorders and non-epileptic events. Now, after spending years, I mean years, witnessing the deleterious effects of neurological disorders, Dr. Douyon realized that there were a better way to treat these disorders and to serve the people than to prevent the decline of brain health while supporting supporting body health. So without further ado, I'd like to bring them on our special guest, Dr. Philippe Douyon, and let me give him the special VIP treatment. Hey, Dr. Douyon, how you doing?
I'm good, Steve. Thank you for having me on, and thank you for that awesome introduction.
Man, thank you. You look young. I mean, does anybody ever tell you that?
I mean, people tell me this all the time. I definitely think I look younger than I really am.
I mean, wow. So let me ask you, first of all, I'd like to publicly thank your marketing strategist, Clifford, thank you for setting this up and promoting the show. I saw the ads that he put out there, and I just wanted to thank Clifford for that.
Yeah, Clifford is awesome. So I thank him as well.
So, Dr. Douyon, let me ask you, before we start with your story, again, I want to thank you for being candid and sharing your story. But look, many doctors don't share that part of their life on social media. What made you share your journey with kidney disease on social media? Because we see the video out there of you in recovery, just getting the transplant, and then you got videos of your last treatment at DaVita. What made you share this part of your life when so many other doctors are private with that part of their life?
You know, I think that there's this myth that doctors are somehow supposed to be perfect. We're supposed to be of perfect health. And the reality is that we're just like everybody else. So we also have our health issues. And for me, a lot of times when I'm seeing patients, what allows me to connect really, really well with them is the fact that I've been a patient for more than half my life. So I completely understand what they've been through. I understand what it feels like to look in the mirror and not recognize who you are anymore. I know what it feels like to take a whole bunch of medications and have side effects. I know what it's like to face your mortality. So that really allows me to connect with people. That allows me to understand what they're going through, understand what it is that they want out of life, and really to help them overcome some of the health challenges that they're facing so that they can create the life that they want for themselves.
Wow, that's awesome. Now, let's start with your journey with kidney disease. How does that begin?
So that actually begins my freshman year of college. So I was a college athlete. I grew up playing and competing in tennis, and I was on the college tennis team. And so when you're on a athletic team, you've got to go for your physical, right? So this was now August of my freshman year. I go for my physical, and they find proteins and urine and proteins and blood in my urine, and they're not sure why. So I actually failed my initial physical. But they told me, look, come back in a couple of days, we'll recheck everything and we'll kind of take it from there. So I came back a couple of days later, and again, they found proteins and blood in my urine. And again, they didn't know why, but this time they cleared me to play because we had a pretty big tennis tournament coming up. So I go to compete in this tennis tournament, and I'm actually playing my second match of the day. And I go to serve, and I collapse to the ground, and I could no longer move the muscles in my body. Every time I tried to move, another muscle would spasm.
Wow.
And so I ended up in the ER in this small little town in Pennsylvania. You know, and they rehydrated me. They took some blood, took some urine, and they kind of, the nurse then told me, look, when you get back to New York, you want to see a kidney specialist. And that's really how my kidney journey began, was that freshman year of college.
Wow. And you weren't even a doctor yet.
Oh, no. I was far from being a doctor.
So what did they diagnose you with?
So initially, I went to go see a kidney specialist maybe a couple months later. And initially, I was diagnosed with post-strep glomerulonephritis.
Wait a minute. Mention that again. Post-strep glomerulonephritis.
Yeah. So what they thought was that I had been exposed to streptococcal at some point. So like when people get strep throat. And that as a result, my body, my immune system started to attack my kidneys. We'd find out a couple of years down the line that wasn't the case. I actually had another kind of kidney disease.
Mm. So doc, a lot of people, we all hear that diabetes and hypertension are the two leading causes. And we also hear about these other common causes like polycystic kidney disease, lupus. But you rarely hear people talk about streptococcal causing kidney disease, and that can happen.
Yeah, and that can happen. Look, when you have a viral infection, right, your body wants to do everything to clear that virus. And sometimes your other organs become collateral damage. And so that's initially what they thought was going on with me.
Mm-hmm. So how long were you on dialysis, or when did you start dialysis?
So I actually went through college, then went through medical school in kidney failure, never doing dialysis. And
wow.
8 days after I graduated from medical school, 8 days after I walked across the stage at Carnegie Hall and got my med school diploma, I walked into New York Presbyterian Columbia and had a kidney transplant. And at that time, I was 28 years old, and I was fortunate enough that my father was my kidney donor. So he really saved my life.
All right, Dad.
Yeah, and I got to avoid dialysis.
Okay, but how long did that transplant last?
So that transplant lasted 14 years. And so over the last 2 to 3 years, my kidney function had actually been deteriorating, and we were planning to have another kidney transplant. And again, I was really fortunate. I had a donor, my cousin-in-law, Scott Singleton. And so we were kind of slowly doing the workup throughout 2020. And then in January or late December, beginning of January this year, I ended up getting COVID and was hospitalized for 2 weeks. And that accelerated my kidney function or my kidney disease. And so I actually then needed dialysis. And dialysis was the thing that I was most scared of having. And so I ended up on dialysis in January, and I did dialysis for about 4 months.
Okay. Wait a minute. Let's go back. You said being the founder of the NLE Brain Fit Institute, you was actually scared of doing dialysis?
Yeah, I was terrified of dialysis. I mean, the reason being that every time I saw somebody on dialysis in the hospital, it looked like they had no quality of life. Some of them looked like they were essentially waiting to die. And so when I was told that I needed dialysis, you know, it was really scary for me. And I took probably like a good 24 hours to process that, go through my feelings. And then I needed to make a decision. Was I going to do dialysis the way that I saw people in the hospital doing dialysis? Or was I going to do dialysis my own way? And so I decided I was going to do dialysis my own way. And dialysis can be brutal on the body, right? It's exhausting. At least for me, I had a lot of cramps. I was tired afterwards. But during dialysis, I would work. I would take meetings. I would give interviews. I was doing dialysis later in the day. So that way it gave me a maximum time to recover, right? So I would be done with my dialysis maybe like around 7 o'clock. It gave me that evening and night to, you know, to sleep and sort of recover. I'd wake up the next day and I can sort of go about my life a little bit more. And then, you know, it would be that second day I would have to do dialysis again, but it gave me the maximum time to recover and enjoy my quality of life, which was really important to me.
Now, how did you push through that fear of overcoming going on dialysis? At some point you had to reason with yourself that, like you said, you had to make a decision. But for people who may be watching the show right now that may be starting dialysis or about to or doing dialysis now that try to still push through those feelings, what helped you?
Yeah, I think what helped me was realizing that this was going to give me the best opportunity to get to a kidney transplant and be healthy enough to go through that process, right? And so also what I was doing was in between dialysis sessions, I was trying to have as much of a life as I could, you know, during COVID time. So I would exercise, right? I would do the little exercises I could do. I would spend plenty of time with my sons. I was still working on, you know, on my business. I was still doing podcasts and doing interviews and, you know, helping other people. And that's one of the things that I find that is really important is when you have those moments where you're feeling down on yourself, like we all go through, especially during tough times, shift your focus off yourself and do something for somebody else, right? Mm. And the reality is that we're in healthcare. And so we're constantly doing for other people, right? So it's not so hard for us to shift the focus off ourselves. You know, that releases a lot of endorphins in the body. So it gives you energy. It allows you to feel good about yourself. But it also gives you a purpose outside of just you, which is really important.
Right, right. So like, say someone's dealing with kidney disease or kidney failure, they're on dialysis, maybe say going to a hospital and volunteering and helping people who could be a little bit worse off than someone with kidney failure would be something great, or just helping other individuals who may be dealing with situations of their own could help them out.
Absolutely. And the reality is that if you're dealing with kidney failure or dialysis, your experience is so vitally important to other people. Right, you have an experience that allows you to relate to other people, allows you to help other people, and that's incredibly important. It allows you to connect with others. And so, you know, I would suggest that whatever tough times we go through, we really try to turn them into our strength, because we can really use that experience to help as many people as possible.
Wow, that's powerful. Now, let me ask you, how did you come to the decision of getting into neurology?
Yeah. So I actually knew that I wanted to be a doctor before I was diagnosed with kidney failure. So before I went to college, I was sort of moving in that direction. And for me, what sparked my interest in neurology was when growing up, I had a cousin who had epilepsy, right? And she was able to grow out of epilepsy, which is great. And then two, when I was a teenager, my grandmother was diagnosed with Alzheimer's. And even though those are two really difficult disorders to witness, it allowed me to appreciate just how powerful and beautiful the brain is when it's working the way that we want it to. And when people are using their brains to create the life that they want instead of allowing their brains to use them.
Mm-hmm. Now, let me ask you a question. I'm going to go back to your transplant. Your cousin donated to you, and so y'all went through the process. Was there ever, did you ever experience any anxiety of going through that waiting process for that kidney?
So yeah, there was definitely a little bit of anxiety. I had my second transplant actually May 27th of this year.
No, congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. And for me, what I was most anxious about was just making sure that my cousin-in-law was going to be good and healthy, right? First and foremost, I wanted him to be the priority, his health to be the priority. And so that was what I was most anxious about.
Mm-hmm. Wow. How much of an impact has kidney disease had on your life and your career?
Oh, I think it's had a huge impact. I mean, I've lived more than half my life at this point with kidney disease. Like I said before, it allows me to relate to my patients really, really well. It allows me to see the world from a completely different perspective, right? I've faced my mortality at this point several times throughout my life, right? So knowing that tomorrow is not always guaranteed and being grateful for what you have today, not living in the past, not focusing all the time on things that may or may not happen in the future, and really just enjoying the present moment, right? So even when I was going through dialysis, and you've got moments where you just feel kind of crappy, you're cramping, you're low energy, you just don't feel great, but then really appreciating and enjoying the moments where that's not the case, where you're feeling pretty good. Mm-hmm. So kidney disease has had a pretty significant impact on my life.
Let me ask you, what could you recommend to someone that's doing dialysis and experience those feelings that you just said? I mean, they feel like it's the humdrum day in, day out, the rigmarole. And say they may or may not be on the transplant list. What suggestions could you give these individuals to help them I don't want to say accept, but deal with the process, or I guess accept, because at some point you have to accept what's going on. But what suggestions could you offer individuals who feel like this is just, they're not living a life, they just existing?
Yeah. And so this might be a little bit tough for a lot of people, but this is something that I did. So in my course, I talk about the secret to life is evolution. The secret to life is that each individual needs to evolve, they need to develop themselves. And so even when you're going through something that's as difficult as dialysis, in those moments where you're not feeling bad, it's about focusing on developing yourself. So exercise is focusing on developing your body. Reading may be a focus on developing your mind. Finding a way to develop yourself spiritually, right? Surrounding yourself with people who really support you, who are going to be there for you, who are going to check in on you, people that you can rely on. And sometimes it's just for like a good conversation, or who will just sort of come around and make sure that things are going okay. But I think that those things are all really important. And those are the things that really helped me, was developing myself in different ways, as well as making sure I had a core group of people who love me, who appreciate me, who respect me, and who wanted nothing but the best for me.
Wow. And listen, you can just only apply this to kidney disease, but you can apply it to other diseases as well, correct?
Absolutely. You can apply this to, you know, if you're undergoing any medical or neurological problem, or if you're facing any challenge in life, or if you just want to really live a great life and create the life that you've always dreamed of. I think that development is key. Developing yourself, evolving yourself is key, but also surrounding yourself with really good people. Because the reality is that our brains, have you ever noticed something like, if you scratch your nose, somebody that you're talking to may scratch their nose just a few seconds later? Our brains are designed so that they mirror the actions and feelings of the people that we surround ourselves with, right? And so surround yourself with really great, positive people, because you'll start to act in that way, you'll start to think in that way.
Oh man, that's some great tips. So is that the same way, like if I'm with my daughter and we just sitting down talking and she yawns 1 minute and then 3 minutes later I'm yawning? Is that the same?
That's the exact same thing. So that's an awesome example. And in fact, the neurons, the cells in the brain, will start to fire at the same frequency as the people that you surround yourself with the most.
Wow. I mean, you're absolutely right about that. I noticed that when I went to nursing school, hanging around nursing students, colleagues who were all doing the same thing. And finally, the brains rapid fire and caught on, and it was like a cohort
yeah.
of individuals learning the same thing.
Absolutely. And that's why they even say, like, if you have a group of five people who are spending a lot of time together, chances are at some point their salaries will start to match, right? So it's incredibly important that you surround yourself with really great people. I mean, as a doctor, I've seen patients where, you know, they've got some preventable chronic disease that's due to the lifestyle choices that they're making, which aren't so great. And the people that they surround themselves with are other people that are making poor lifestyle choices. Right? And so you're not going to get better if you're not surrounding yourself with people who can support you in the way that you need.
Wow. Wow. That's powerful. Now, let me ask you, Dr. Douyon, what have you learned about yourself during this process of overcoming COVID-19,
yeah.
dialysis, and successfully getting a second transplant? Because I didn't know you were a two-time transplant recipient.
Yeah.
What did you learn? What have you learned about yourself during this whole process share with us?
Sure. So it's funny. If you asked me this 2 weeks ago, I would have said, look, I'm resilient. I persevere. But a couple of weeks ago, my sons said to me, oh, Papi, you're really, really stubborn. And I was like, I'm not stubborn. Right. And then I was thinking about it. And I was like, you know what? They're absolutely, absolutely right. Because if I was not stubborn, I would have passed away at least three times this year, right? So I overcame COVID, I overcame dialysis, I got my second kidney transplant. There's a stubbornness in me that is like, no, I want to live this life. I want to enjoy this life. I want to help as many people as possible. And this is not yet my time to go. So not only am I resilient, not only do I persevere, but I'm also a little stubborn. So my sons are right.
Wow. Now, when you did your outpatient dialysis for the 4 months, were you treated any differently because of your status as a medical doctor, or was it even known that you was a medical doctor?
So it was known that I was the medical doctor. The place that I did dialysis was DaVita in Jamaica, Queens on Hillside Avenue, and their staff was amazing. Not just with me because I was a doctor, but with everybody. I mean, they had music playing every single day, and it would be like hip hop, reggae. I mean, there was sometimes you felt like you were in the Caribbean somewhere. The nurses were just incredible, right? They talked to you about what was going on with you medically, but also just talked to you on a sort of personal level. And they did that with everybody. You know, I think the challenge for me is that as a doctor, I need to allow other people to do what they do best, right? And so that was something that I realized early on. And it's not being like, why is the dialysis machine beeping? Maybe you want to switch the tubes around or whatever. It's let them handle what they're going to handle, right? That's their expertise. But they were amazing.
Wow. That's something I got to take that advice on, especially when I go to the hospital and I try to intercede when I'm a patient or something, when I should let the people at the hospital do their work and step out of my role as a nurse.
You know, it's good to know what's going on. And so if you've got questions or if you've got serious concerns, but yeah, sometimes it's just like, let them do what they do best and just be the patient right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's change gears for a moment and talk about the Inlee Brain Fit Institute. Tell us about that. How did that come about?
Yeah, so it is a health and wellness organization that I created. And it came about actually a few years ago when I was in a big group private practice focusing on epilepsy, but also seeing other neurological disorders. And one of the biggest myths that people have when it comes to brain health is that the way that we live our lives, the decisions that we do make every single day, don't have an impact on our brain health. And the reality is that that is so far from true. We see a lot of people who develop strokes because of poor lifestyle choices that they've made. We see a lot of people develop Alzheimer's disease or other dementias because of poor lifestyle choices that they make. Even sometimes people develop seizures and epilepsy because of lifestyle choices that they've made. And so in preventing neurological diseases and chronic medical diseases, your lifestyle has a lot to do with it. But it's not just in prevention. If you want to heal from a neurological disease, like a stroke, if you want to minimize your risk of having seizures, a lot of that has to do with the choices that you make. And so at the Emily BrainFit Institute, it's about teaching people that, showing them how the decisions that they make every single day in terms of the foods they eat, their level of activity, the substances that they choose to ingest, all have a significant impact on brain health, and that they are capable of not just preventing neurological and medical disorders, but also healing themselves from those things by the actions that they decide to take every day.
Wow. Now, is this all, how is this done? I mean, is any medication used in this process?
No,
or
so,
your treatment?
Yeah, so through the Emily BrainFit Institute, I don't prescribe any medication. So it's all done without us even prescribing a single pill. But what I do is prescribe exercise regimens for people based on their neurological and medical challenges that they're facing. May even prescribe certain foods to eat based on their medical and neurological challenges that they're facing. And we now have our online course, which really helps people as well.
Wow. Now, talk about the course. How is that set up?
So the way that the course is set up is that it's more than 70 pre-recorded videos that people have access to. And the focus of the course is teaching people how having a mission, vision, and purpose is crucial to your overall health and the quality of your life. Teaching them how your brain evolves based on your mission, vision, and purpose. It's about teaching people how every choice that they make throughout the day influences their brain's evolution. Teaching them how to become the leader that their brain so desperately needs them to be. It's about teaching them how chronic medical illnesses impact their brain health. And then it's also teaching them how to create a prescription plan that's rooted in the development of their mind, body, and soul to really improve their overall health, but especially their brain health.
Mm-hmm. I noticed one of the conditions that you address is PTSD. Now, let me ask you, we know in the urban community, there is trauma from murders, the violence that happens in urban communities. Could that assist with someone dealing with that type of trauma or PTSD from like violence?
Yeah, absolutely. So when we think about trauma is like stress on the body taken to like the nth degree, right? And so what we see is that when your body is under that level of stress, it starts to release a lot of different chemicals, which in the short term may be beneficial, but in the long term has a detrimental effect. And so one of the things that we see is that there are areas of the brain, especially areas that are responsible for making short-term memory, that start to atrophy. So you lose the ability to make new memories, right? And so you'll hear a lot that people who have experienced traumas, they're constantly thinking about that trauma. And even if you give them a completely new experience, it's almost like they can't appreciate that experience because they're always focused on the trauma, even though it's something that happened in the past. And part of that is because their hippocampus, the part of the brain responsible for making new memories, shrinks. And they can't make new memories in the same way. We know that chemicals that are released, like cortisol, will increase your risk of diabetes. It will decrease your bone mass, so you tend to get weaker, you tend to get more obese. So trauma has a significant negative impact on your body as well as on your brain.
Wow. And what you do at the Inlay Brain Fit Institute is kind of turn that around and help individuals push through that and kind of live a healthy brain life, per se.
Absolutely. To teach them the things that they can do to keep their brains healthy, to push through the challenges that they're facing, and allow them to really create the life that they've always dreamed of living.
Wow. Yeah, we're going to definitely bring you back in about 3 weeks for another show just talking about brain health, and have a great conversation on that. So kind of winding down on the show, but I wanted to ask you, Dr. Douyon, other than the information that you gave a suggestion for warriors, kidney warriors, what information, other information can you share that will help kidney patients get started to overcome their situation that may be watching right now? Say they want to, like tomorrow, like start to make a change or make a difference on the way they think of how they approach kidney disease or kidney failure or even dialysis treatment, because you have patients who may skip treatments or get off early or may not follow the recommended 32-ounce daily allowance, or they may eat more foods with potassium or phosphorus. What can you just share as we end to these individuals on pushing past those deleterious, as you call it, effects pertaining to dialysis?
Yeah, so you know, the really interesting thing is that science teaches us that we have somewhere between 12,000 and 60,000 thoughts per day. And out of all those thoughts that people are having per day, 90 to 95% of them are the same exact thoughts that they had yesterday. And 60 to 70% of those thoughts are negative thoughts. So I would say that one of the things that people really need to do is they need to start thinking differently. And the way that you do that is by giving yourself a completely different experience. You can do that by, you know, reading certain books. You can do that by listening to people who inspire you. You can do that by having a different experience, like traveling. So when I was on dialysis, I think three different times I traveled to California and did dialysis in California. And that's an option that's available to a lot of people. So organizations like DaVita, who provide dialysis service, they provide dialysis services all over the world. And so if you need to take time away, you can do that. If you want to take a vacation, you can do that. If you want to go visit a loved one, you can do that. And so I think really giving yourself a completely different experience instead of just going through the motion is going to be really, really important.
Awesome. Wow. That was great. I appreciate that, Dr. Young, because there's a lot of individuals, as you know, not just in the United States, but across the world that, you know, don't have access to dialysis as we do in the United States. They may only get to go to treatment maybe twice a week. They just don't have the luxuries as we do here in some places across the world. So thank you for that information. Do you want to give any shout outs you'd like to give out before we kind of end the show?
Yeah.
Colleagues?
Yeah, I really want to shout out, you know, we shout out Clifford at the beginning, who's done some great marketing work for me. But I really want to shout out my support system. So my parents have been awesome. My cousin Lisa has been amazing. Her husband Scott was my donor. My girlfriend Lonnie has been a real support throughout this process. So they were my circle, and I really want to shout them out and let them know how much I love and appreciate all of them.
That's awesome. That's awesome. So, Doc, would you be willing to come back in several weeks to talk about your program and give some people some opportunity to ask questions and talk about brain health and how people can stay healthy?
Absolutely. You name the time and I will be there.
All righty. All right, guys. Dr. Philippe Douyon. Again, are you still working at New York Presbyterian?
No. So now, since this pandemic started, I've been doing a little bit of teleneurology, but the big focus has really been on my course, which is called Take Charge of Your Brain. And then I also have a book out called Neuroplasticity, Your Brain Superpower.
Yeah, put a plug in for that. Tell us, where can we get that book? And tell us a little bit about, I forgot all about your book. Tell us about Neuroplasticity, Your Brain Superpower.
Yeah, so the book is available on Amazon. It's available at Barnes & Noble. And so it's really about how our brains adapt, learn, and heal, and things that people can do every single day to control their neurological destiny.
Okay, and then one more. You got a character for kids, the neurons?
Yeah, I've got the children's book, Neuri the Neuron, which people can find on my website. So it's a little neuron character that I created to teach kids about their brain and to teach them how they can start taking charge of their brains and creating the life that they want for themselves.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome. That would be a great discussion, especially about kids and brain health and what's happening now with social media and everything centered around that and how the brain, like you say, it mirrors stuff. So you got kids doing stuff they see on social media that may be harmful and they don't realize that it's harmful.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've got to, you know, we've got to tackle these issues at a young age, right? Because it's a lot easier to influence and mold children. You know, adults tend to be a little bit tougher.
Wow. Wow. All right, guys. Again, Dr. Philippe Douyon, MD, neurologist, up in New York City, author of Neuroplasticity, Your Brain Superpower, and founder of the Inlay Brain Fit Institute. Thank you, sir, for coming on. I really appreciate your time this evening and look forward to having you back and having a discussion on brain health.
Thank you so much. I look forward to that discussion also.
All right, Doc. Take care. Have a good evening.
All right. You too. Take care.
All right. Bye-bye. Guys, this was a great show. Again, I want to thank Dr. Douyon for coming on. I'd like to thank his marketing strategist, Clifford, who made this happen as well. And I'd like to thank the many people who commented. We got like 96 comments, engagements. That's a record. But thank you guys for tuning in to Steve the Kidney Nurse Show, and look forward to upcoming shows starting around the mid-August. So look, guys, take care of yourself. We got this Delta variant of COVID out. So if you haven't got vaccinated, get vaccinated. Stay healthy, wear your mask, 6 feet apart. Keep doing your part and flattening the curve. So thank you guys for coming on. We'll see you again. God bless. Tomorrow, Hope with Bella will be on at 8:30, I believe. So we see you guys then. Take care. God bless. See you soon. Peace.